Laudato Jesus Christus, praise be Jesus Christ. Welcome to the live broadcast of Pope Francis's Mass at the John Garang Mausoleum in South Sudan. The whole of the weekend, Pope Francis has been visiting South Sudan on an ecumenical pilgrimage for reconciliation and peace. He is accompanied on this pilgrimage by Justin Welby, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and Right Reverend Dr. Ian Greenshields, the moderator of the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. Pope Francis is this morning celebrating Holy Mass, as I've said, here at the John Garang Mausoleum for the people of South Sudan. It is the last activity before Pope Francis returns to the Vatican today. I'm Father Paul Samasumo, and with me here is Father David Gentry. Before I ask him to introduce himself, allow me to acknowledge our partner television and radio stations. Glad that you could join us. Welcome to Luminous Radio, Catholic Faith Network in America, Shalom World Television Networks, Shalom TV India, Sunday Shalom, Salt and Light TV, Atmadashan TV, EWTN TV, and Catholic TV. To those of you following us on Vatican News, website, YouTube, on other social media channels, on shortwave radio, diocesan radio stations, welcome. We have been having some technical issues. I'm sure those who were watching yesterday, we ask you to bear with us. Father David, last evening I was just reading some of the reviews. I was just saying last evening I was reading some of the reviews and articles about this ecumenical pilgrimage. By all accounts, it seems to have been a positive visit by the three leaders. They have spoken frankly with the political leaders, and also they have encouraged peace in South Sudan. And now the visit is coming to an end. Maybe you could just say a bit about yourself and also what's your take so far.
Good morning, Father Paul, and thank you for allowing me to be with you this morning. As Father Paul mentioned, I'm Father David Gentry, the mission promoter for Solidarity with South Sudan. Solidarity with South Sudan is an intercongregational initiative sponsored by the two unions of superiors general here in Rome, the International Union of Superiors General, which represents women's congregations around the world, about 1,900 of them, and then the USG, which represents men's congregations based here in Rome or in Western Europe. So I would say, having visited South Sudan myself and knowing a little bit about the context of that country, this visit by the Holy Father and by the other ecumenical leaders, Archbishop Welby and Moderator Greenshields, it will go live on in the hearts and memories of these people for a long time. They feel very much abandoned by the international community and neglected, and they feel that their issues, which are so overwhelming and seem intractable, seem very difficult to resolve. So the people on the ground suffer a great deal. Poverty, ethnic violence, fear simply for their daily safety and well-being. So this visit of the Holy Father and his reaching out to them with such love and compassion is not only bringing them great comfort and consolation right now, but I think it will continue to sustain them in the months and in the weeks and months ahead.
The Holy Father now starting the Mass.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God I have lived this sin in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have felt, through my fault, through my fault, and never will be fruit. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, the Virgin, and the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
And now we prepare for the Kyrie, Pope Francis beginning the Mass there. And so lovely to see him say the Mass in English.
Let us pray. Keep your family safe, O Lord, with unfailing care that relying solely on the hope of heavenly grace, they may be defended always by your protection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
The first reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58. Thus says the Lord, share your bread with the hungry, shelter the oppressed and the homeless, clothe the naked when you see them, and do not turn your back on your own. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your wound shall quickly be healed. Your vindication shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, here I am. If you remove from your midst oppression, false accusation, and malicious speech, if you bestow your bread on the hungry and satisfy the afflicted, then shall rise for you in the darkness, and the gloom shall become for you like midday. The first reading there, taken in Arabic from Isaiah chapter 58. And now we have the responsorial psalm. The just man is a light in darkness to the upright.
Who conducts his affairs just one shall be everlasting remembrance, an evil report he shall not fear. His heart is found trusting in the Lord.
Let us not be stand up, let us not be stand up, let us not be stand up, let us not be stand up.
His heart is lavishly he gives to the poor. His justice shall endure forever. His own shall be exalted.
From the first letter of Saint Paul to the Corinthians. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, proclaiming the mystery of God, I did not come with sublimity of words or of wisdom, for I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness and fear and much trembling. And my message and my proclamation were not with persuasive words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of spirit and power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. The word of the Lord.
So that was the second reading, the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 2. Very large congregation, as we have seen in these days. 70,000 people gathered in this mausoleum of John Garang to celebrate and welcome Pope Francis, as we heard in the opening songs when Pope Francis did the rounds on his Pope Mobile.
Yeah.
And now the gospel reading. John chapter 8, verse 12. Rather, the gospel is from Matthew chapter 5, verse 38 to 48. The deacon ready to take the reading for us this morning.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt loses its taste, with what can it be seasoned? It is no longer good for anything but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city set on a mountain cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and then put it under a bushel basket. It sits on the lampstand where it gives light to all in the house. Just so, your light must shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your heavenly Father." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So now we prepare to listen to the message of the Holy Father in the homily at this Mass. Must say that Father Gentry, it's quite heartwarming to see the politicians standing side by side, John Garang, his vice president there. And that's how it should be, I think. And if anything, that these two men and all these leaders have come together this month shows just what is possible and what they could achieve for South Sudan.
I think so, Father. I think coming together around the message of Jesus and the gospel and finding our common humanity in our expression of faith is really the only way forward for humankind and certainly for this country. You see these people all at peace, praying together, singing together, being together. That's the only way forward for us.
And may it be like this always. Today, I would like to make my own the words of the Apostle addressed to the community of Corinth in the second reading and repeat them here before you. When I came to you, brethren, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Yes, Paul's concern is also mine. As I gather here with you in the name of Jesus Christ, the God of love, the God who achieved peace through His cross, Jesus, the God crucified for us all, Jesus crucified in those who suffer, Jesus crucified in the lives of so many of you, in so many people in this country. Jesus, the risen Lord, the victor over evil and death. I have come here to proclaim Him and to confirm you in Him, for the message of Christ is a message of hope. Jesus knows your anguish and the hope you bear in your hearts, the joys and the struggles that mark your lives, the darkness that assails you, and the faith that, like a song in the night, you raise to heaven. Jesus knows you and loves you. If we remain in him, we must never fear, because for us too, every cross will turn into a resurrection, every sadness into hope, and every lament into dancing. Most likely we will have the translation in English, and I think just getting the audio together. Pope Francis just began his homily there.
Today, I would like to make my own the words that the Apostle Paul addressed to the community of Corinth in the second reading and repeat them here before you. When I came to you, brethren, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God in lofty words of wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Yes, Paul's concern is also mine as I gather here with you in the name of Jesus Christ, the God of love, the God who achieved peace through his cross. Jesus, the God crucified for us all. Jesus, crucified in those who suffer. Jesus, crucified in the lives of so many of you, in so many people in this country. Jesus, the risen Lord, the victor over evil and death. I have come here to proclaim him and to confirm you in him, for the message of Christ is a message of hope. Jesus knows your anguish and the hope you bear in your hearts, the joys and struggles that mark your lives, the darkness that assails you, and the faith that, like a song in the night, you raise to heaven. Jesus knows and loves you. If we remain in him, we must never fear, because for us too, every cross will turn into a resurrection, every sadness into hope, and every lament into dancing.
Vorrei dunque soffermarmi sulle parole di vita che il nostro Signore Gesù ci ha rivolto oggi nel Vangelo. Voi siete il sale della terra, voi siete la luce del mondo. Che cosa dicono queste immagini a noi, discepoli di Cristo? Anzitutto siamo sale della terra. Il sale serve a dare sapore al cibo, è ingrediente invisibile che dà gusto a tutto. Proprio per questo, fin dai tempi antichi, è stato visto come simbolo della sapienza, cioè di quella virtù che non si vede ma che dà gusto al vivere e senza la quale l'esistenza diventa insipida e senza sapore. Ma di quale sapienza ci parla Gesù? Egli utilizza questa immagine del sale subito dopo di aver proclamato ai suoi discepoli le beatitudini. Capiamo allora che sono esse il sale della vita del cristiano. Le beatitudini, infatti, portano in terra la sapienza del cielo. Rivoluzionario il criterio del mondo e del mondo comune di pensare. E che cosa dicono le beatitudini? In poche parole, affermano che per essere beati, cioè pienamente felici, non dobbiamo cercare di essere forti, ricchi, potenti, bensì umili, miti, misericordiosi. Non fare del male a nessuno, ma essere operatori di pace per tutti. Questa, dice Gesù, è la sapienza del discepolo e ciò che dà sapore alla terra che abitiamo. Ricordiamoci, se mettiamo in pratica le beatitudini, se incarniamo la sapienza di Cristo, non diamo un buon sapore solo alla nostra vita, ma anche alla società, al paese dove viviamo.
I would like to reflect then on the words of life that our Lord Jesus Christ spoke to us in today's gospel. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. What do these images say to us as disciples of Jesus? First of all, that we are the salt of the earth. Salt is used to season food. It is the unseen ingredient that gives flavor to everything. Precisely for this reason, since ancient times, salt has become a symbol of wisdom, a virtue that cannot be seen, but that adds zest to life, which without it becomes insipid, tasteless. Yet, what kind of wisdom does Jesus mean? He uses the image of salt immediately after teaching his disciples the Beatitudes. We see then that the Beatitudes are the salt of Christian life because they bring the wisdom of heaven down to the earth. They revolutionize the standards of this world and our usual way of thinking. And what do they say? In a word, they tell us that to be blessed, to be happy and fulfilled, we must not aim to be strong, rich and powerful, but humble, meek and merciful, to do no evil to anyone, but to be peacemakers for everyone. This, Jesus tells us, is the wisdom of a disciple. It is what gives flavor to the world. This, Jesus tells us, is the wisdom of a disciple. It is what gives flavor to the world around us. Let us remember this. If we put the Beatitudes into practice, if we embody the wisdom of Jesus, we will give savor not only to our own lives, but also to the life of society and of the country in which we live.
Ma il sale, oltre a dare sapore, ha un'altra funzione essenziale ai tempi di Cristo: conservare i cibi perché non si corrompano, diventando avariati. La Bibbia, però, diceva che c'era un cibo, un bene essenziale che andava conservato prima di ogni altro, l'alleanza con Dio. Perciò a quei tempi, ogni volta che si faceva un'offerta al Signore, si metteva un po' di sale. Ascoltiamo infatti che cosa dice la Scrittura in proposito. Nella tua oblazione non lascerai mancare il sale dell'alleanza del tuo Dio. Sopra ogni tua offerta porrai il sale. Così il sale ricordava il bisogno primario di custodire il legame con Dio, perché Lui è fedele a noi, la sua alleanza con noi è incorruttibile, inviolabile e duratura. Perciò il discepolo di Gesù, in quanto sale della terra, è testimone dell'alleanza che Lui ha realizzato e che celebriamo in ogni messa, un'alleanza nuova, eterna e frangibile, un amore per noi che non può essere inclinato neanche dalle nostre infedeltà. Fratelli e sorelle, siamo testimoni di questa meraviglia. Anticamente, quando delle persone o dei popoli e stabilivano tra loro un'amicizia, spesso la stipulavano scambiandosi un po' di sale. Noi che siamo sale della terra, siamo chiamati a testimoniare l'alleanza con Dio nella gioia, con gratitudine, mostrando di essere persone capaci di creare legami di amicizia, di vivere la fraternità, di costruire buone relazioni umane, per impedire che prevalgano la corruzione del male, il morbo delle divisioni, la sporcizia degli affari iniqui, la piaga dell'ingiustizia.
Salt does not only bring out flavor, it also has another function, which was essential at the time of Christ. It preserves food so that it does not spoil and go bad. The Bible had said that there is one food, one essential good that is to be preserved above all others, and that is the covenant with God. So in those days, whenever an offering was made to the Lord, a little salt was added to it. Let us hear what Scripture says about this. You shall not let the salt of the covenant with your God, be lacking from your cereal offering. With all your offerings, you shall offer salt. Salt thus served as a reminder of our basic need to preserve our relationship with God, because He is faithful to us and His covenant with us is incorruptible, inviolable, and enduring. It follows that every disciple of Jesus, as the salt of the earth, is a witness to the covenant that God has made and that we celebrate in every Mass. A new, eternal, and unbreakable covenant, and a love for us that cannot be shaken even by our infidelity. Brothers and sisters, we are witnesses to this wonder. In ancient times, when people or peoples established a pact of friendship with one another, they often sealed it by exchanging a little salt. As the salt of the earth, we are called to bear witness to the covenant with God with joy and gratitude, and thus show that we are people capable of creating bonds of friendship and fraternal living, people capable of building good human relationships as a way of curbing the corruption of evil, the disease of division, the filth of fraudulent business dealings, and the plague of injustice.
Oggi vorrei ringraziarvi perché siete sale della terra in questo paese. Eppure, dinanzi a tante ferite, alle violenze che alimentano il veleno dell'odio, all'iniquità che provoca miseria e povertà, potrebbe sembrarvi di essere piccoli e impotenti. Ma quando vi assale la tentazione di sentirvi inadeguati, provate a guardare al sale e ai suoi granelli minuscoli. È un piccolo ingrediente e, una volta messo sopra un piatto, scompare, si scioglie, però è proprio così che dà sapore a tutto il contenuto. Così noi cristiani, pur essendo fragili e piccoli, anche quando le nostre forze ci paiono poca cosa di fronte alla grandezza dei problemi e alla furia cieca della violenza, possiamo offrire un contributo decisivo per cambiare la storia. Gesù desidera che lo facciamo come il sale. Ne basta un pizzico che si scioglie per dare un sapore diverso all'insieme. Allora non possiamo tirarci indietro, perché senza quel poco, senza il nostro poco, tutto perde gusto. Iniziamo proprio dal poco, dall'essenziale, da ciò che non compare sui libri di storia, ma cambia la storia. Nel nome di Gesù, delle sue beatitudini, deponiamo le armi dell'odio e della vendetta per imbracciare la preghiera e la carità. Superiamo quelle antipatie e avversioni che nel tempo sono diventate croniche e rischiano di contrapporre le tribù e le etnie. Impariamo a mettere sulle ferite il sale del perdono, che brucia ma guarisce. E anche se il cuore sanguina per i torti ricevuti, fratelli e sorelle, rinunciamo una volta per tutte, a rispondere al male con il male, e saremo bene dentro. Accogliamoci, amiamoci con sincerità e generosità, come fa Dio con noi. Custodiamo il bene che siamo, non lasciamoci corrompere dal male.
Today I would like to thank you because you are the salt of the earth in this country. Yet, when you consider its many wounds, the violence that increases the venom of hatred, and the injustice that causes misery and poverty, you may feel small and powerless. Whenever that temptation assails you, try looking at salt and its tiny grains. Salt is a tiny ingredient, and once placed on food, it disappears, it dissolves, yet precisely in that way, it seasons the whole dish. In the same way, even though we are tiny and frail, even when our strength seems paltry before the magnitude of our problems and the blind fury of violence, we Christians are capable to make a decisive contribution to changing history. Jesus wants us to be like salt. A mere pinch dissolves and gives a different flavor to everything. Consequently, we cannot step back, because without that little pinch, without our small contribution, everything becomes insipid. So let us start from the little things, the essential things, not from what may appear in the history books, but from what changes history. In the name of Jesus and of his beatitudes, let us lay down the weapons of hatred and revenge, in order to take up those of prayer and charity. Let us overcome the dislikes and aversions that over time have become chronic and risk pitting tribes and ethnic groups against one another. Let us learn to apply the salt of forgiveness to our wounds. Salt burns, but it also heals. Even if our hearts bleed for the wrongs we have suffered, let us refuse once and for all, my brothers and sisters, to repay evil with evil, and we will grow healthy within. Let us accept one another and love one another with sincerity and generosity as God loves us. Let us cherish the good that we are, and not allow ourselves to be corrupted by evil.
Passiamo alla seconda immagine usata da Gesù, la luce. Voi siete la luce del mondo. Una famosa profezia diceva di Israele: io ti renderò luce delle nazioni, perché porti la mia salvezza fino all'estremità della terra. Ora la profezia si è compiuta, perché Dio Padre ha inviato suo Figlio, ed è Lui la luce del mondo, la luce vera che illumina ogni uomo e ogni popolo, la luce che splende nelle tenebre e dissipa le nubi di qualsiasi oscurità. Ma lo stesso Gesù, luce del mondo, disse ai suoi discepoli che anche loro sono luce del mondo. Ciò vuol dire che noi, accogliendo la luce di Cristo, la luce che è Cristo, diventiamo luminosi, irradiamo la luce di Dio. E Gesù aggiunge: non può restare nascosta una città che sta sopra un monte, né si accende una lampada per metterla sotto il moggio, ma sul candelabro, e così fa luce a tutti quelli che sono nella casa. Si tratta anche in questo caso di immagini familiari di quei tempi. Diversi villaggi in Galilea erano sulle colline, ben visibili da lontano, e le lampade nelle case erano poste in alto perché facessero luce in tutti gli angoli della stanza. Poi, quando dovevano essere spente, si coprivano con un oggetto di terracotta chiamato moggio, che faceva mancare l'ossigeno alla fiamma fino a estinguerla.
Let us now pass to the second image used by Jesus, which is light. You are the light of the world. A great prophecy was told in Israel: I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. Now that prophecy has been fulfilled because God the Father has sent his Son, who is the light of the world, the true light that enlightens every person and every people, the light that shines in the darkness and dispels every cloud of gloom. Jesus, the light of the world, tells his disciples that they too are the light of the world. This means that when we receive the light of Christ, the light that is Christ, we become luminous, we radiate the light of God. Jesus goes on to say, a city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. Again, this was a familiar image in those days. Many villages in Galilee were built on hillsides and were visible from a great distance. Lamps in the houses were placed high so that they could illumine all the corners of a room. When a lamp was extinguished, it was covered with a piece of terracotta called bushel, which deprived the flame of oxygen and thus put out its light.
Fratelli e sorelle, l'invito di Gesù ad essere la luce del mondo è chiaro. Noi che siamo Suoi discepoli siamo chiamati a splendere come una città posta in alto, come un lucernere la cui fama non deve essere mai spenta. In altre parole, prima di preoccuparci delle tenebre che ci circondano, prima di sperare che qualche cosa attorno si rischiari, siamo tenuti a brillare, a illuminare con la nostra vita e con le nostre opere le città, i villaggi, i luoghi che abitiamo, le persone che frequentiamo, le attività che portano avanti. Il Signore ce ne dà forza, la forza di essere luce in Lui, per tutti. Per tutti devono poter vedere le nostre opere buone, e vedendole, ci ricorda Gesù, si apriranno con stupore a Dio e gli daranno gloria. Se viviamo come figli e fratelli sulla terra, la gente scoprirà di avere un Padre nei cieli. A noi è dunque chiesto di ardere di amore. Non accada che la nostra luce si spenga, che dalla nostra vita scompaia l'ossigeno della carità, che le opere del male tolgano aria pura alla nostra testimonianza. Questa terra bellissima e martoriata ha bisogno della luce che ciascuno di voi ha, o meglio, della luce che ognuno di voi è. Carissimi, vi auguro di essere sale che si sparge e si scioglie con generosità per insaporire il Sud Sudan con il giusto fraterno. Vi auguro di essere comunità cristiane luminose che, come città poste in alto, gettino una luce di bene su tutti e mostrino che è bello, è possibile vivere la gratuità, avere speranza, costruire tutti insieme un futuro riconciliato. Fratelli e sorelle, sono con voi e vi auguro di sperimentare la gioia del Vangelo, il sapore e la luce che il Signore, il Dio della pace, il Dio di ogni consolazione, vuole fondere su ciascuno di voi.
Brothers and sisters, it is clear what Jesus means by asking us to be the light of the world. We, who are his disciples, are called to shine forth like a city set on a hill, like a lamp whose flame may not be extinguished. In other words, before we worry about the darkness surrounding us, before we hope that the shadows around us will lighten, we are called to radiate light, to give brightness to our cities, our villages and homes, our acquaintances and all our daily activities by our lives and good works. The Lord will give us strength, the strength to be light in him, so that everyone will see our good works, and seeing them, as Jesus reminds us, they will rejoice in God and give him glory. If we live like sons and daughters, brothers and sisters on earth, people will come to know that all of us have a Father in heaven. We are being asked then to burn with love, never to let our light be extinguished, never to let the oxygen of charity fade from our lives, so that the works of evil can take away the pure air of our witness. This country, so beautiful yet ravaged by violence, needs the light that each one of us has, or better, the light that each one of you is. Dear brothers and sisters, I pray that you will be salt that spreads, dissolves and seasons South Sudan with a fraternal taste of the gospel. May your Christian communities shine radiantly so that, like cities built on a hill, they will shed the light of goodness on all and show that it is beautiful and possible to live with generosity and self-giving, to have hope and together to build a reconciled future. Brothers and sisters, I am with you, and I assure you of my prayer that you will experience the joy of the gospel. The server and the light of the Lord, the God of peace, the God of all consolation, desires to pour out upon every one of you.
So there we are, Pope Francis's message in his homily to the people of South Sudan, taking or making as his own the words of St. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. When I came to you, I did not come to you proclaiming testimony of God in lofty words or wisdom, inviting the people of South Sudan to be the salt we know that in ancient times still is today. Salt is a precious ingredient, and not only in cooking, but also for preserving food, inviting the people of South Sudan to be that salt, and also using the image of light that they may radiate and be the light to others.
Thank you, Father. Yes, I think if the people of South Sudan can come to really believe that about themselves, to really sense God's presence within each of them and among them, they have the possibility of moving forward in peace and building a great nation that will be a blessing for the whole continent of Africa and for the whole world. It's a matter of coming to really believe that deeply and then making choices that flow from that profound conviction.
And it is true, Father David, that it is not only the people of South Sudan who suffer, the neighbors suffer when things do not go well, and the whole continent of Africa suffers indeed.
Yes, because of the violence that's taking place in South Sudan, you have so many people having to flee the country, and they become refugees in neighboring Kenya and Uganda. And so the suffering and the violence and the devastation that goes on there affects the whole continent and affects all of us. It's truly the case that we are one body in Christ, and so when one part of the body suffers, we all suffer.
And again and again we have heard yesterday, today, the Holy Father saying, I'm with you, I'm with you. And he has demonstrated that way beyond, I think, what would have expected.
Yes, I think just the fact that this great man, the leader of the worldwide Catholic Church, makes the effort to come to this part of the world which is struggling and suffering, and spending so much time with these folks, with the internally displaced people yesterday, listening to their stories and responding to their stories in such a deeply personal way. He is reminding them that God is with them, and that through him the presence of Christ is with them, and that even when he leaves this land and returns to Rome, he will continue to carry them in his heart and continue to pray for them and to want the best for everyone of South Sudan, for all of these beautiful young people who have hopes and dreams for a better future.
And in a way, we have been part of that struggle during these transmissions. We've seen the hiccups in transmission. It just speaks to you in ways, you know, there it is before your eyes, the struggles that this country is having.
Yes, the folks of South Sudan are, in many ways, in virtue of the technological limitations, they often, I think, feel cut off from the rest of the world. There was a young man that I was trying to help to apply to be able to study at a university in Europe, in Belgium, the Catholic University of Louvain. And we had so much difficulty just for him to be able to complete the application process because of the technological limitations. He wasn't able to fulfill he's a brilliant young man. He wasn't able to fulfill all of the bureaucratic requirements to be able to complete his application because of the internet limitations and all of that. So they feel very, I think, very cut off and isolated from the rest of the world.
So now we have the creed, the recitation of the creed. We are told that all in all, 100,000 people are attending this mass. Initially, at the beginning, they were about 70, according to the estimates that have been made by the authorities there. But 100,000 people at this mass. And now we are going to have the intercession prayers, the beating prayers.
as we don't make our prayer for our community and for the world, let us pray to Christ the Lord, not only for ourselves and our own needs, but for the entire people.
من أجل حبرنا العظم البابا فرانسيس ومن أجل الأساقفة والكهنة وشمامسة وشعب الله كله لكي يتحدوا بيسوع الذي هو الحق والحياة ينال النور والقوة والشجاعة.
Praying for Pope Francis then in Arabic.
Ogarok erin bindin my bay ping nam aben kwa pedit pandan chweni Sudan wada madol eyin bany bany ina limku ba biokan chakwany biwo bio doj biguba pial kuyeke nyechang we dengu biwo ngay mach del biogruel chinitiel utektegetok rok bainda.
So that is in the Dinka language, one of the languages spoken in South Sudan, praying for young people in the nation of South Sudan, and also for peace and generosity in the face of all the challenges that this country is having.
Lian kuate lupude teton kuke isi tise bongo kitani akwe na togeleng nangotuli koto durjo kopusan nangotu bukulu.
Another of the languages there in South Sudan, Bari, and praying for families, the elderly, the married, the children of this nation, that they work together in unity as one people for the benefit of everyone.
Ka queen ene di altin chiliu ka shate gensof ka kui malaka binyuz nikien abom raila dada kwa linko.
That was a prayer in Nuer, one of the languages there in South Sudan, one of the big languages and tribes there, praying for those that are deceased, especially those that have worked for peace in the past, that their example for peace will live on.
Tipo gwa borodwa ene dunduko Dukina sa rogo para fumboli na ngbarago Tipa nilingeka aliaga nilingara kurogo poro zereda Koda chise na rurumanga apai Anikwari dunduko sa kinia.
In Zande, praying for all those that are present at this Mass, that they will be all filled with joy and that they will all recommit themselves to building a nation, one nation for all.
Incline your merciful ears to our prayers, we ask, O Lord, and listen in kindness to the supplication of those who call on you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, who have willed that we be partakers in the one bread and one chalice, Grant us, we pray, so to live that, made one in Christ, we may joyful be and freed for the salvation of the world. Through Christ our Lord.
We are slowly coming towards the end of this wonderful celebration in South Sudan. And right now we do expect His Grace Archbishop Stephen Martin Mayu of the Catholic Archdiocese of Juba, who is hosting the Holy Father, to say a few words of gratitude for this visit of Pope Francis to Juba.
Your Grace, Justin Welby, Right Reverend Dr. Ian Greenshield, Your Eminences, Your Lordships, the President of the Republic, and all the government officials, allow me to call all of you brothers and sisters. Your Holiness, Pope Francis, on behalf of the members of the Sudan Catholic Bishop Conference, I warmly thank you and also thank Almighty God for having allowed this historic visit to happen in our time. Furthermore, I thank you very much for taking this bold decision to visit our country, which is suffering due to the consequences of war. Your Holiness, I believe your visit is a sign of solidarity with us and so shows the desire to restore tranquility in this country. Your Holiness, you have come to our country to urge our political leaders, to work for peace and for the common good of Sudan and South Sudan. You have demonstrated this concern previously in your repeated calls for reconciliation between the warring parties. In April 2019, for example, you hosted South Sudanese leaders for 2 days spiritual retreat in the Vatican, during which you urged them to strengthen the country's faltering peace process. Amazingly, you even knelt down to kiss their feet as a symbol of humility and service of humanity. However, it is discouraging that the peace process has moved forward so slowly. Your Holiness, we share your fatherly concern for the restoration of peace in our country. War has brought the indiscriminate destruction of human lives and the destruction of assets such as homes and livestock. We have experienced looting, raping, economic deterioration, and the displacement of countless people, many of whom have fled to neighboring countries. Thus, with such a negative impact of civil war upon our innocent people, one can say it is better to have peace than to have war, because war destroys as whereas peace builds. Your Holiness, despite the above mentioned challenges, our civil war, the church in South Sudan and Sudan has grown. Indeed, though we have lived throughout tough historical periods, we have celebrated 100 years of faith in this country. On one hand, our church has produced two saints, Saint Daniel Comboni and Saint Josephine Bakita. And on the other hand, the local church has witnessed to the faith through martyrdom. Among those martyred during the first civil war, known as Anyanya I, that lasted almost from 1956 to 1972, were William Deng, Saturnino, Father Saturnino Okure, and Father Leopoldo Anuar. There has been martyrs of the current civil war as well. Sister Veronica Teresa from Slava, and sister, she was a medical doctor, was killed on May the 16, 2016, while serving in the Catholic Diocese of Ye. Sister Mary Abud and Sister Regina Ruba from the local congregation of the Sacred Heart of Jesus were also killed on August the 16, 2021, while they were on their way back to Juba from the celebration of the centenary of Our Lady of Assumption Parish in Lower, in the Catholic Diocese of Torit. Your Holiness, our country is truly suffering due to the civil war. Therefore, we are looking for peace and reconciliation. However, the peace which our country so badly needs is not a purely human peace based on personal interests, but rather the peace of Christ, who says, "Peace I leave you with you, my peace I give you. Not as the world give you, but do as I do it to you." This is the peace, my Holy Father. This is the peace that we in this country need, and the love and saying the truth. In conclusion, Your Holiness, once again, with all your friend, Dr. Ian, Dr. Justin, we thank you for coming to this country. You have pushed us further in building of peace. May this great event of your visit bring us blessing and peace to this country and also in our sister country, Sudan. Thank you very much.
Archbishop Stephen Ameyo, the Archbishop of Juba, giving a vote of thanks to Pope Francis there, and mentioning also the need for peace in Sudan, a neighboring country with South Sudan. Gift being displayed there of a chalice. Pope Francis has given a gift of a chalice to the Archdiocese of Juba, or to the Church of South Sudan, rather. And we had the Archbishop there stray from his speech, saying that you have pushed us further in this journey of peace, in spite of the frustrations that he mentioned, that the peace process has been slower than was expected.
Caro fratello Stephen, per queste parole. Saluto il signor Presidente della Repubblica, insieme a tutte le autorità civili e religiose presenti. Sono ormai giunto alla conclusione di questo pellegrinaggio in mezzo a voi e desidero esprimere riconoscenza per l'accoglienza ricevuta e per tutto il lavoro svolto per preparare questa visita, che era una visita fraterna in tre. Sono grato a tutti voi, fratelli e sorelle.
I'm grateful to all of you, brothers and sisters, who have come here in great numbers from various places, spending many hours, if not days, on the road. I thank you for the affection you have shown me, but also for your faith and your patience, for the good you do and the hardships that you willing offer to God without growing discouraged, but continuing to move forward. South Sudan possesses a courageous church with close ties to the church in Sudan, as the Archbishop noted in referring to the Saint Josephine Bakita, a great woman who by God's grace transformed into hope all the suffering that she endured.
Doveva raggiungere molti, raggiungere tutti. Speranza è la parola.
Hope is the word I would love to leave with you as a gift to share, a seed to bear fruit. As Saint Josephine Bakita reminds us, women, especially here, are a sign of hope. And in a special way, I thank and bless all the women of this country.
Thank you, dear brother Stephen, for your very kind words. I greet the President of the Republic, as well as the civil and religious authorities present. I have now come to the end of this pilgrimage among you, and I want to express my gratitude for the warm welcome given me and for all the work done to prepare for this visit. I am grateful to all of you, brothers and sisters, who have come here in great numbers from various places, spending many hours, if not days, on the road. I thank you for the affection you have shown me, but also for your faith and your patience, for the good work you do and the hardships that you willingly offer to God without growing discouraged, but continuing to move forward. South Sudan possesses a courageous church with close ties to the church in Sudan, as Archbishop noted in referring to Saint Josephine Bakita, a great woman who, by God's grace, transformed into hope all the sufferings that she endured. As Pope Benedict observed, the hope born in her, which had redeemed her, she could not keep to herself. This hope had to reach many, to reach everybody. Hope is the word I will leave with each of you as a gift to share, as a seed to bear fruit. As Saint Josephine reminds us, women, especially here, are a sign of hope. And in a special way, I thank and bless all the women of the country.
Alla speranza vorrei associare un'altra parola, la parola di questi giorni, pace. Con I miei fratelli Justin e Ayn, che ringrazio di cuore, siamo venuti qui e continueremo ad accompagnare I vostri passi, I tre insieme. Siamo venuti qui facendo tutto quello che possiamo perché siano passi di pace, passi verso la pace. Vorrei affidare questo cammino di tutto il popolo, ma con noi tre, questo cammino della riconciliazione e della pace a un'altra donna, e la nostra tenerissima Madre Maria, la Regina della Pace. Ci ha accompagnato con la sua presenza premurosa e silenziosa. A lei ora preghiamo, affidiamo la causa della pace in Sud Sudan e nell'intero continente africano. Alla Madonna affidiamo anche la pace nel mondo, in particolare in numerosi paesi che si trovano in guerra, come la martoriata Ucraina. Carissimi fratelli e sorelle, torniamo, ognuno di noi tre, alla propria sede, portandovi ancora di più nel cuore. Lo ripeto, siete nel nostro cuore, siete nei nostri cuori, siete nel cuore dei cristiani di tutto il mondo. Non perdete mai la speranza e non si perda l'occasione di costruire la pace. La speranza e la pace dimorino in voi, la speranza e la pace dimorino in Sud Sudan.
To hope, I would associate another word, the word that has echoed in these days, and this I desire with all my heart in the days to come, peace. I came here with my brothers, Justin and Ian, whom I sincerely thank. We will continue to accompany your steps and do all we can to make them steps of peace. Steps to peace, I would like to entrust the path of reconciliation and peace to another woman, the greatest and at the same time the least, the most exalted and yet the one closest to us. To each one of us, she is our most loving Mother Mary, Queen of Peace. She has accompanied us with her caring and quiet presence. And the statue that depicts her as Our Lady of Africa is here with us. We pray to her now and entrust to her the cause of peace in South Sudan and in the entire African continent, where so many of our brothers and sisters in the faith experience persecution and danger, where great numbers of people suffer from conflict, exploitation, and poverty. To Our Lady, we also entrust peace in our world, especially in many countries at war like Ukraine, which suffers so greatly. Dear brothers and sisters, I return to Rome with you even closer to my heart. Let me repeat it. You are in my heart. You are in our hearts. You are in the hearts of the Christians worldwide. Never lose hope and lose no opportunity to build peace. May hope and peace dwell among you. May hope and peace dwell in South Sudan.
Pope Francis's remarks there just before the Angelus recitation of the Angelus prayer, reminding them, the people that are gathered there, reminding us all that he returns to Rome closer, feeling closer to the people.
The Lord be with you. Blessed the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
So we have come to the end of this celebration. Father David, we need to say our goodbyes.
It's been a great privilege to be with you, Father Paul, and to be able to participate in these wonderful events of the last 3 days. And it's been my blessing and privilege.
Thank you very much for your presence, Father David. Gentry there. With that blessing of Pope Francis, at the end of this celebration, as Father Gentry has said, an extraordinary, really touching and moving service that we have witnessed. And the past 3 days of Pope Francis in Juba, really, really emphasizing and bringing his love to the people of South Sudan. Let me now just thank our partner television and radio stations, and thank all of you who have been following us on social media. You can find more details on our website, vaticannews.va. Thank you to Luminous Radio, Catholic Faith Network in America, Shalom World Television Networks, Shalom TV India, Sunday Shalom, Salt and Light TV, Atmadashan TV, EWTN TV and Catholic TV. I'm Father Paul Samasumo. Laudato Jesus Christus. Praise be Jesus Christ.
should move from his place. Please be seated. All the volunteers, security, don't allow anybody to move.
Ismo Aleu, O Mama Beta Aluel Aluel, Jana Saraya, Mama Beta Aluel Tal Gidam, Tal Gidam, and Mama Beta Aluel, Isima Ayen, Ayen, Mama Ismo Ayen.